The views and opinions expressed on this program are those of the participants and do not reflect the views of God's Net or the program underwriters.
Bronstein. Your voice, your views, your vision.
Coming up tonight on Perspectives, are you buried in credit card debt or worried about how to get your credit score up and going? Well, we've got a special guest in the studio to let you know about that, as well as the pitfalls when it comes to credit cards. We'll talk about that right now. Perspectives.
Anything relevant to life, you bring it to the table. Whether you make your move solo or a movement with a stable. No fables or speech on your decisions. Cause in the long run, it's your voice, your views, your vision. Keeping it real with many messages for you to know. This ain't radio, but DJ runs the show. Entertainment, he rocks it. Politics, he locks it. The host with the most would handle any topic. Don't forget to share your perspective, which shines a light. Cause it might make a difference in someone else's life.
We encourage you to always check us out on the website, www.bronstead.org. And, of course, if you want more information, you can always check us out on our Facebook page. You'll be able to find out more information about the show. Well, as you know, it is the new year, and the new year is upon us. And as it's a new year, new resolutions, time to get things right. And some of the things that we need to get right are our finances and credit. And as we begin a new year and try to get the house in order, if you will. But one of those things that many people have to struggle with is the issue of credit cards. The question about credit card scores, how do you get your credit card information, or should say credit information, and what do you do when you have a credit card problem or a credit problem? Well, joining us now in studio is somebody who's going to help us out with that information. Carol Painter is our guest in studio. She's a senior attorney at the Federal Trade Commission. And Carol, thank you so much for joining us here on Perspectives.
Great,
Aaron. When we talk about credit as a whole, I think sometimes people underestimate the value of credit. Share with us a little bit about the value of credit in the lives of Americans today.
Yeah, that's an excellent starting point because credit is so essential for most people today. You know, there are many ways we want to purchase a home, we want to purchase a car, and your credit is an essential part of that. Because most of us, let's face it, aren't coming in with $50,000 for their car or to purchase their home with $200,000. So having good credit is the best way for most of us to get a little further in society. Having good credit means a score, I believe, in about 600 to 800. There are several companies, private companies, that actually calculate what your credit score is, and they share that among creditors. So for you as an individual, it's important for you to begin to build credit, and how do you do that? You do that really by being on time with loan payments. I mean, most of us, student loans, for example, might come out with our student loans. Paying them on time is the way to begin to establish your credit. And any opportunity you have, if you have a store card, you might have a little card at Best Buy or something like that, paying on time is the best way to establish your credit.
You know, one of the things I think people don't understand is the fact of how quickly you can ruin your credit.
Absolutely, absolutely. Little, your late 30 days, it starts to get reported. I mean, there was a time in the past when it wasn't reported so quickly, but everybody's a little tighter with credit today. You know, we've had our financial crisis in the country. Banks are less willing to lend credit if they think you're not going to be responsible. So, yes, it is important for you to be on time with all of your payments, and that's the first step, really, to maintaining your credit. It'll be a day late, a day. It begins to pile up, and they develop your credit history. And when your credit history is bad, that's not good for you.
So when credit history is bad, it has an adverse effect on the life of people because then loans become higher interest rates.
Absolutely.
Show us the disadvantage or the, you know, disadvantages of having a poor credit score and poor credit history.
Well, first of all, as you mentioned, it's very hard to get credit if your credit history is poor. If you have a history of delinquencies where you have been late all the time, or you have a history of not paying them where you have your debt written off, is what they call it, those things count against you. So if someone wants to lend you some money, extend credit to you, they're going to look at that to say, well, what sort of person is this? And is it a trustworthy person? Can I lend this person money, and will they pay it back on time? So that's the first thing. You may never get a loan if you're really bad on credit. But as you mentioned, if you are also having a poor history, you will have to pay more to borrow if you will get borrowed. So you see them all over the place. You might borrow a car at 25%, where someone else whose credit is good is 5%, 0.3%. So when you see, for example, on television, those car companies advertising really great interest rates, those are for the A people.
Because you usually see the little thing on the screen at the bottom that you can't read.
Exactly.
But that thing on the screen at the bottom that you can't read is the fact that, you know, these are for A-list.
Exactly.
Credit score.
Exactly. So, but if your credit is a little bit, you know, spotty, you're not going to get that access. So it's important to maintain your credit in as good a way as you can. I mean, people have situations, you know, they arise, and sometimes financially you have some problems. But you have ways to fix your credit also, which we can get to as we go further. I mean, the worst outcome for you could be that you'd end up filing bankruptcy. You know, if your credit gets so bad that you can't pay your creditors and they're all knocking at your door, ultimately you might have to file bankruptcy, which is not the best thing to do.
When you're in a situation, because many people do suffer with bad credit, but here's the thing, many people suffer with bad credit and don't even know that they've got bad credit. How often should a person be engaged in checking their credit score?
Well, there's two things, actually. The FTC several years ago created a way that you can check your credit history. And there's a website called annualcreditreport.gov. And it's a free service where you can go on and you'll be asked questions like your Social Security number. You'll be asked what a recent loan you had or what recent payments you made, just so they can verify that it's you. And you'll have an opportunity to pull your credit history from the three credit reporting companies, TRW, Experian, and TransUnion. And doing that, what we advise you actually is to only pull one at a time. So, for example, through the course of the year, you could every 4 months pull a copy of your credit history for free. And that will just show you all the payments. It will make sure that all the payments are being made, that they were really your credit, you know, credit accounts. They aren't somebody else with your name, or sometimes people misuse your credit, so you can just make sure it's clean. But the credit score is actually a separate thing, because as I mentioned before, the credit score is actually sold by private companies. So in order to get your credit score in New York State, you have to pay $8. So that's a different thing. So you can get a free report just showing your history. It's about 20 pages if you've been in, you know, as an adult, all the various things that we do. It'll be about 20 pages worth of all of your history, and that's one thing, but there's no score with that.
Mm.
And so that's different. Now, when you go and you call one of these companies and say, I'd like my credit score, as I said, as a New York State resident, you will pay $8, and they will send you what your actual score is.
So you can get your score, but most importantly, your history. How did the history and the score correlate?
So basically, the companies will look at your history, how you paid credit, how much credit you had, you know, obtained, because also there are many things that can count against you. Having too many credit cards can count against you. You know, a lot of times we want to open every store card, we want every catalog that comes in, oh, you have $200 of credit, and we think that's a great deal. But ultimately that's going to count against you, because if someone wants to lend you, let's say, a mortgage, when you go and you have 20 different cards, even though they're small amounts, they will say that you could access all of that money and they won't lend you money. So it's not always good. If you have cards that you don't use, it's better to close them. And close them and don't use them if you're not, you know, and get rid of them for your credit history.
And credit history also plays an important part, whether you're getting a condo or
absolutely. And indeed, it plays a part now with insurance, because some companies can look at your credit score and say, do we want to give this person insurance? And some employers also look at your credit history. So, you know, certainly the government, if you want to work for the government, they will check your credit history, because when you've been paying on time, it's a sign of maturity. It's a sign of being a responsible person. On the other hand, when you're not paying on time, or you have even your AT&T card, your wireless card, you never pay the bill, those things count against you. Mm-hmm. So it's important for you to know what people are seeing when they look at your credit history. And if you can fix it, you can.
I want to get ready to take a break, but after I come back after the break, I want to talk about these little credit card scams.
Sure.
And, you know, these debt repair scams, because there are many people out there who really want to get their house in order, their life in order. They really want to be able to repair their credit and repair their, you know, and work to do some things. But when you look out there, you see these annoying companies that are going to help you, but they actually hurt you. We'll talk about that when we return right here on Perspectives.
In uncertain times, what can you be sure about? The sun rises in the east. What goes up must come down. Night follows day. Well, here's something else. When it comes to dealing with debt collectors, federal law gives you rights. For example, debt collectors can't call before 8 in the morning nor after 9 at night. Can't curse or insult you. Can't demand that you pay more than you owe. Can't lie about anything. They can't say that papers they send you are legal forms if they're not. Nor can they make up consequences for not paying your debt. And they can't call you at work if your employer doesn't allow it. You also have the right to stop debt collectors from calling you. How do you do that? You have to notify them in writing. Sending them a letter should stop the phone calls, but of course, doesn't wipe out your debt. There's helpful information about dealing with debt at ftc.gov/moneymatters, a website from the Federal Trade Commission. It explains the rules of behavior for debt collectors. Take a look. There are some that may surprise you. If your debts have gone into collection, remember that you have rights. Asserting your rights doesn't make your debt go away, but it does give you a voice. The more you know about how to manage your debt and deal with debt collectors, the better off you can be. After all, money matters. If you think that a debt collector has violated the law, report it. File your complaint with the Federal Trade Commission at ftc.gov/complaint. Your complaint gives law enforcement a lead to follow up on and may stop it from happening to someone else. The Federal Trade Commission is the nation's consumer protection agency. For more tips on credit and debt, visit ftc.gov/moneymatters or 1-877-FTC-HELP. 1-877-382-4357.
We're back here on Perspectives. Darren, I'll be here with you. So glad to have you here with us. We are talking about credit cards, talking about credit history, how to get yourself right in the new year. As you know, many Americans in the new year try to make New Year's resolutions, and one of the things is how to get themselves economically stable, and that comes through credit and credit history and credit cards and finances. So we're taking the time here, our Perspectives, to really take a look at some of the things that you can do in that arena to be able to help you out. And our guest in studio, Carol Painter, who's a senior attorney for the Federal Trade Commission. And Carol, before the break, we were sharing a little bit about people who are being scammed. Because we turn on the television, all hours, all channels, somebody's trying to help us get out of debt. But everybody on every channel isn't honest and forthright.
Exactly.
I want to be able to take the time, because this is something that you do, actually, as a senior attorney for the Federal Trade Commission. You guys actually go after those people who are scamming.
Absolutely. So, I mean, you raise a good point. How do you get out of debt, or how do you get out of credit trouble? There are lots of offers out there to help you. They have one, for example, called advance fee loans. And that's when somebody's telling you, even though you have bad credit, and you've been denied for a loan from everybody, Tom, Dick, and Harry, we can still get you a loan. And you pay $150 to somebody, and then what they do, they send you a list of people you can ask to get a loan from. You know, whereas they've told you, we've guaranteed you a loan, and it's false.
Right.
So that's one thing. That's called advance fee credit card. People get them all the time, and what those kinds of people do, they actually buy lists of people who have poor credit histories. And then they send them an offer, and they send them $150, and the scamster walks away fat and happy, and you're left with just paper and no credit. Another kind of scam is what they call debt relief. and you see it on TV all the time, you know, we'll get you out of debt in 2 years. And the problem with that is that you're not told all of the downfall that you'll experience with that kind of a program. What they'll do is they'll tell you, pay us, instead of paying your creditors, pay us a lump sum of money, and then we'll start to negotiate and pay down your debt. Well, people end up 5 years in the hole, basically haven't paid, they didn't pay the creditors, they're getting sued left and right, they're in court all the time with judgments, and these companies don't help you out. So you're ending up thousands of dollars in debt, more so than when you started out.
What should people know when approaching companies such as this? Because there are some, you know, do not do lists.
Absolutely. I mean, for example, that last company I talked about, the Federal Trade Commission recently enacted some legislation that said they have to disclose to you all of the pitfalls. So you should know what you're getting into. That, you know, certainly you can, they can negotiate for you if you'd like them to, but you should know that when they do that, they're not going to pay your creditor for 8 months. And then you're going to start getting collection notices. You're going to start getting all kinds of calls from debt collectors telling you, and sometimes even ending up in court.
You said 8 months.
Yes. Sometimes they don't pay for 8 months. Before you're just paying them $300 a month. They take a fee out of that, and they put aside the rest of it, and ultimately may pay your creditor at some point. But it's a very, very, very difficult road when people get into that because you get trapped ultimately. You know, after a year, you haven't paid your creditor, and then you want to get out of this program, and they haven't paid your creditor either, how are you going to start back now? Because you've got penalties that have been loading up on your, you know, your late credit payments. You've got fees that have been loading up. So you're just really, you're in between a rock and a hard place at that time.
Is it better for an individual just to handle it themselves?
Absolutely. You just said the best thing. The Federal Trade Commission actually publishes a lot of brochures about how to fix your credit. You know, we give you sample letters that you can call, you write, send to your creditor and say, you know, I can't only pay this amount right now. Can I negotiate a payment schedule with you? And most creditors are willing to do that. So we do say it is better to do it yourself in the first instance. It's a lot of work. You know, it is a lot of work. You're going to be writing letters and making phone calls. But, you know, it, versus the cost of getting into some of those debt relief programs, it might be worth it your while to do that.
I think that one of the things that happens is sometimes people don't know their options.
Absolutely.
You know, and principally, we know how to get in. Mm-hmm. It's an old saying, you know, it takes, you know, nothing to get into trouble, a lot to get out of trouble, but yet and still don't even know how to get out of trouble. What are the resources available for people who are in this who say, listen, you know what, I got to get out?
Well, one thing, we used to say at the Federal Trade Commission, educated consumer is our best customer. We stole that. You know, from
But it works. Yeah, so you got
you
it.
But it works, and it's the truth. I mean, on the Federal Trade Commission's website, there are numerous, you know, pamphlets and handouts just explaining what are your rights as a consumer. You know, what can you tell a creditor? You know, when should you contact the creditor and how you should contact the creditor? So you're going to be armed with some weapons to help you go forward. Also, another way, though, you could go is to credit counseling. Now, credit counseling companies are not-for-profit companies that are licensed by the state of New York. So it's a little, you know, safer in the sense that they have to be licensed by the state and you're not going to just take your money. When you go into credit counseling, though, you'll have to understand that your credit cards will not be usable anymore. Basically, they'll stop you from using them, but they'll make arrangements with your creditors, and you can have a nice payment schedule where you've paid them off, and at the end, your credit score and your credit history is cleaned up. So that's an opportunity, and it's usually a very small fee that you have in the beginning, but it's another way to get out of your problems.
Well, we hear a lot about these new credit card regulations that were just enacted. So how is this going to actually affect people? I know we talked a little bit about disclosure a few minutes ago, but are there any other effects that are going to come through this new credit card regulation?
Well, I think the probably the biggest thing, and as I mentioned before, the Federal Reserve actually is the one who's promulgated these rules.
Mm-hmm.
What will happen is that as a person who has a credit card, there was a time when credit, you know, you might one day be paying 8% and the next month you're paying 19% and you don't really know why the credit card company sort of hiked it up without telling you. Now they're under the law, they must actually give you 45 days notice that they're about to raise your credit your interest rate, which is very helpful, and you have an opportunity to opt out of keeping that card. So you're not sort of stuck suddenly paying a high interest rate when you weren't aware of it. Mm-hmm. Those are some of the protections now, because people were suffering prior to the, you know, these laws being enacted. But those are some of the things that will help. And I would advise people to go to the Federal Reserve's website, where they can also find some really great information about all the specifics that have been enacted to help them.
I want to talk a little bit about the issue of getting yourself together as far as credit tools in society.
Mm-hmm.
You know, society knows that you gotta have credit in order to be successful. But what are some of the tools that a person can arm themselves with in order to make it when it comes to the issue of credit?
Well, first, if you have credit cards, for example, you should always check your bill monthly, because you want to make sure someone's not misusing your credit account, because identity theft still is the number one complaint to the FTC the last 7 years. It's been the number one complaint that we have received, because we do take complaints from consumers. So you want to make sure, looking at your credit, your monthly report, that nobody has been misusing, you know, your credit card. In terms of arming yourself, certainly you want to not really apply for every credit. You know, everything that comes your way is not worth to apply for, because you get $300 from a catalog, and then you're stuck with a $300 line of credit. And, you know, every other month they say, we're going to give you $500 for it. You know,
right.
And suddenly you're stuck in an ear and a trap. It's your, and I like to advise you, it's your credit. And if you use it, it's a tool to help you maneuver in society and to help you get along in life.
One thing is, we're located here on college campus, and, there's a lot of colleges and college students who watch. Many times, I remember growing up, you used to have these credit card companies actually on college campuses. We know there's been a law to try to deal with that. But talk about the importance of understanding when you fill out these applications and you make these credit card requests, how that affects and damages your credit score.
Absolutely, and particularly students. I mean, that's why the law was enacted, because students were coming out of college with $10,000 of consumer debt, and that was just unacceptable, really. We had students who committed suicide because they ran up credit cards, not understanding what is this credit card really about. If they're like my daughter, she'll say to you, Mom, just go to the ATM machine. We don't always understand money and how it really works. So for students, it's important to understand, okay, maybe it's nice to go and when you all go out to dinner and you pay everybody's bill on your credit card, but a $200, dinner, if you just pay the minimum $10 a month, ultimately that's going to cost you $500. So you have to understand that when you go to buy your pair of pants and it was on sale and you got a great deal, it was a $100 pair of pants that you got for $40, but when you start paying the minimum, it goes up to $200 by the time you're finished. You
right.
have to understand that credit is, I always say, use credit, don't let it use you. So the job of a credit card company or anybody is to make money off of the loan they've made you. So understand, when you spend any money on your credit card, try to pay it the same month, or make a plan to pay it within a certain amount of time, so that you're not really overextending yourself and really getting used by the credit card company.
Carol Payne is our guest in studio, and we're getting ready to wrap things up. And she's a senior attorney for the Federal Trade Commission. And I know there's never a dull day at the Federal Trade Commission. What kind of stuff do you see actually come across your desk from day to day?
We see so many things, from the local construction company that's ripping off the elderly, to a case that I recently brought in Florida, a company that was selling health insurance. It was a medical discount plan that they claimed was health insurance. So you had people who were being denied health insurance because of pre-existing conditions, or they couldn't afford it, buying this, and then when they went to the doctor, nobody accepted it. So this company made about $40 million off of people, and we shut it down this past August. So we see a lot of things that are going on, and we try to educate people. It's a big part of what we do, not just cases, but to educate people that you have rights and how do you find out information. The FTC has a website, as I mentioned, which is www.ftc.gov,
mm-hmm.
and it's a lot of information there for you as a consumer that you can go to and just find out, what should I do in this circumstance? You can call us, too, to find out whether there are complaints against the company, and, we can try. We don't give you advice, but we'll give you the tools to arm yourself to make the good decisions.
One last question. earlier in the show, you talked about getting that credit, you know, finding out your credit history. There's a website that somebody can go ahead and do that. Let's give that out.
Yes. So that is www.annualcreditreport.gov. Now, there is one that sounds like that. That's actually a commercial one. I think it's freecreditreport.com, mm-hmm. which is actually where you would pay. But you don't want that one. You want the government's website, which is annualcreditreport.gov.
And that'll give you credit history and not score.
Not score, right. But it'll get it for free.
Okay. That's what I'm saying. These days for free.
It's for free, yes, yes. So that's where you can find out your credit history. And just take a look and make sure it's you and that everything that's been reported is true.
All right. Carol Painter, our guest in the studio. Thanks so much for sharing these tips with us. Mm-hmm. Carol Painter, Senior Attorney of the Federal Trade Commission. And we thank her for joining us here on Perspective. And our perspective is this. Is that take advantage of all the information that you can get in order to help you in this issue of credit. As the economy continues to rebound and get better, it's important to have credit in order to make it to that next level. So if you can do what you can do in terms of improving your credit score, finding out your credit history, and even researching some of these much-needed tools and resources that can help you, you can be on a better track. And I don't care where you are, you can always get a little bit better. So just do the best that you can in order to make it better. That's my little perspective right there. And I'm Darren Jaime. As you know, Perspective here is every Tuesday night here on Roxas Channel 67. We encourage you to watch us. And we also encourage you to check out our Facebook page as well as give us some information. Send us an email. Let us know what do you think. As far as show ideas, you might be able to share a show idea with us. If you want to see a particular kind of show, just hit us up and we'll do that as well. But for all of us here on the Set of Perspectives, I'm Darren Jaime. We thank you for watching. Until the next time we meet, stay safe and share your perspective with somebody else because it just might make a difference in their life. Take care.
I'm Bronx Borough President Ruben Diaz Jr. BronxNet has trained and provided access to technology for thousands of Bronxites and college students in media production while sharing local programs and important community information by and for Bronxites. We know that the entertainment and media industries are growing here in New York City, and BronxNet helps Bronxites get their career start while producing award-winning local programs. We also know that Cablevision has done extremely well right here in our borough. However, we need Cablevision to be a better corporate citizen by providing BronxNet with the capital and operating funds that it needs so that they can continue to provide quality community access television that Bronxites deserve. So join me, Bronx Borough President Ruben Diaz Jr., and show your support for BronxNet by going to BronxNet.org and filling out a petition so that we can let Cablevision know how important BronxNet is to us and to the Bronx. Thank you.